We have our distinguished panelist. We have Professor Nihata, the inventor of SCR. This is the subject of this debate. So we can have some question about this subject. Professor Nihata, can you start the...
Thank you.
Okay, thank you for coming this session. Now we are starting the SCR session. This is a free discussion session, no presentation, no movie file. So just talk with the panel's experts. So first, introduce everyone to each panelist.
Yes, do you want to start the questions?
Yes, so please introduce yourself, and your name, and you do SCR. If you do SCR, how long you did, when you start SCR, and how many cases you have done? Please tell to the audience.
Okay, yeah. I'm Dr. Cani from Toulouse in France, and I've never done your technique, Dr. Okay. Miata. I only do latissimus dorsi
truncae. Okay.
For the same indication.
I'm John Costuras from Stanford University. I first performed the SCR in 2012, beginning with fasciolata as your technique first described, and I've evolved to use other allografts quite a bit.
Okay. My name is Catherine Angel. I'm from Lisbon, Portugal. I work with Clara. We both do SCR since 2015.
Yes.
Yes. And we have 53 cases together, yes. We do it with fasciolata, harvested by a minimally invasive technique that we developed. We have been premiering, and we're very happy with it.
Okay, so we're a team. We work in Centro Hospitalar de Lisboa Ocidental. I'm Clara Azevedo. What I can add is that we have no experience using allografts or xenografts. We have always used fasciolata. So you can ask this question.
Okay, thank you very much.
So so you believe that SCR works. Can you tell us how it works?
How I believe it works?
Yes.
The mechanism?
Yes.
Well, as Professor Mihata so well explains, the idea is that when you have an irreparable rotator cuff tear, your patient, the patient who presents to you with a painful shoulder that cannot perform forward elevation without pain, and usually cannot perform this shoulder elevation over 90 degrees, is really debilitated in all his daily living activities. And if this patient wishes to restore this painless arc, he has to reestablish the force couples in the shoulder. So the idea of the reconstructing the superior capsule is to allow this patient to use his deltoid again to regain abduction. And for this, he needs to center the glenohumeral joint again. And so usually these patients have a subscapularis tear, an irreparable supraspinatus tear, and sometimes they have an irreparable infraspinatus tear that may be partially repairable. And the idea is to allow for the joint, the force couples, the horizontal force couples of the subscapularis and the teres minor and the deltoid to restore the elevation. And for this, we need what our colleague just before explained, we need the rotator cuff hug. So we need to reestablish this bridge. And by reconstructing the superior capsule and suturing the posterior margin of the superior capsule to the infraspinatus remains, and by repairing anteriorly the subscapularis tear, these patients do recover from a pseudo-paralysis state. And this procedure is brilliant. Because we had this niche of patients who were too young to have a reverse, and sometimes too complicated, as we have discussed earlier also, to understand how to use a latissimus dorsi transfer, which requires a very selected niche of patients. And we had these patients, we were too young for this, too complicated, and this procedure is really simple. It's accessible to everyone who has the skills to repair rotator cuff tear. It's not more complicated than that. You just add a graft and you fix it to the glenoid instead of repairing a rotator cuff. So this is why this procedure convinced me, because of the results. Professor Mihata,
I understand your passion for SCR.
Sorry.
Thank you. Jean, do you believe that SCR works? Do you believe that it's
the question is why? Why I don't use it? So it's difficult. So why? I think what is a pain generator of a cuff or a massive cuff tear? Because I agree with the indication. I think indication probably are very close. In fact, the same. Probably the bicep first could be a pain generator, and second the disbalance of the shoulder. So maybe for some patient there is no indication of repair something or to do SCR or even a lat dorsi. You just cut the biceps. The problem is for me when you have a recurrence of a pain after a first surgery. So you have no supra, no infra, no biceps. You cannot cut the biceps again. For me, I do the lat dorsi because it's a dynamic. It's not for me a tenodesis effect like you can sometimes listen in some congress. For me, it's a dynamic effect. Our mistake a few years ago was to try to fix the lat dorsi over the top in order to push down the humeral head to prevent the superior migration. And it was a mistake because even if biomechanically it was logical, we had a lot of rupture of our lat dorsi at the junction between the bone and the tendon or the tendon and the muscle because too high a tension. So now we just put the biceps posterior onto the footprint on the infra. The condition is to have a very good subscap. And if you have a very good subscap, you rebalance the shoulder with a lat dorsi, and then you can treat the patient, and it's dynamic and biologically. It's not artificial.
Okay.
Manos, can I just say something?
Okay.
Now you can. I think the key idea here is when you have a irreparable rotator cuff tear, you have a lack of fulcrum. You don't have a fulcrum for the deltoid. So you, in order to get this shoulder to function again, you have to get a fulcrum. It can be SCR, it can be tendon transfer. You have to put something that counterbalances the deltoid for us to do this.
Okay.
This is the idea.
Now that you add this, there are some referrals that the failed SCR the fair also works. Do you believe? How can you justify it like this?
This is.
Do you disagree with this or not? We agree with this or not?
When you talk about SCR, you're talking about a large bag of procedures associated with SCR and a lot of types of SCR. Somebody can say anything about something. So maybe in one patient or another, it may work because of other things that keep the fulcrum. If the fulcrum is there, it works because that's the centralization that everybody's talking about. So yes, it can work, but
I think it's a question of timing. When did this SCR fail? Because if at some point it was there, this fulcrum was reestablished and the shoulders had an opportunity to rebalance. And then at some point it ruptured, and then you have to follow this patient to see what is going to happen. Another question is, what are the outcome measures used to assess these patients that the authors claim that it works the same way? Because if you use subjective outcome measures, this will depend on the type of patient and on the type of demands this patient puts on his or her shoulder. Because for an office clerk, it's different to lose the external rotation strength than a manual worker. So you need to assess the strength to compare these patients to say if it works or not, because almost certainly you will find differences in shoulder strength among patients with failed rotator, failed superior capsule reconstructions and the others. So the question is, most of the studies out there only assess subjective, only use subjective tools, and you have lots of variables, as Katerina said, and you don't analyze these variables with regard to the demands of these patients on their shoulders to see the impact subjectively to them, because most of our patients just want to get a night's sleep. Okay. And this procedure takes the night pain away. And some are satisfied with only this, and others are not. So this is the real question for me.
You also have massive rotator cuff tears that function.
Okay, John.
So you should stop repairing everything.
Who's your indication for SCR? Who's the perfect candidate for SCR?
So it's all about indications, right? So I think that for me, it's a massive irreparable tear, supraspinatus or supra and infraspinatus, advanced fatty infiltration. Sometimes you can usually assess this preoperatively, oftentimes intraoperatively. A younger patient, minimal arthritis. For me, proximal migration is a relative contraindication. I have not had the experience of Terry where you can reverse proximal migration with SCR. That has not been my personal experience, durably. I think integrity of the subscapularis is important and a requirement. I think Terry's minor integrity is important. Christian Gerber and I published on factors that led to improved outcomes for latissimus in 2006 or 7. Terry's minor is important, as is subscapularis as well. So that for me. And the final thing is, I have had less consistent results with SCR when patients have pseudoparalysis. So similar to the indications that I use for latissimus transfer, I want the ability of the patient preoperatively to maintain their arm in space with minimal assistance. If the arm drops, that for me is not a candidate for SCR, at least in my hands. So I heard that you've had a different experience, it sounds like, where you can reverse.
Yes.
Pseudoparalysis is another question of debate.
That's it, yes.
What is our agreement or disagreement of what is the definition of pseudoparalysis? For me, true pseudoparalysis, I cannot get the SCR to reverse that.
Why do you think that?
I think the same thing with latissimus transfer. I think there's only a certain degree of added strength score that you can improve upon with any of these procedures.
And how can you measure that?
That's
theoretical, right?
It's theoretical. So if patients are going to just drop down, for me, I need to do something like reverse or something like that to improve upon.
Since
that
is so subjective, maybe you should objectify this. And as we know, Professor Teresa Mihata has experience in performing this procedure in patients with a mother 4 grade rotator cuff tear arthritis, and also you put prosthesis and reconstruct and grade 5. But I don't have that experience, so what I do is I want to treat a patient with an irreparable rotator cuff tear. So I look at the quality of the articular cartilage. In my hands, I'm not sure I'm going to have good results if they have destruction of the articular cartilage. So I choose the patients, a mother 1 and 2. And in these patients, I look at the grade of atrophy of the muscle in the T1 sagittal cut in the MRI. If I have a positive tangent sign, so it's severe atrophy of supraspinatus, I have a high grade of suspicion that I won't be able to repair this tear in this patient, but I will always try anyway. But I discuss it with the patient before. If this patient has a grade 3 or 4 Guttalia fatty degeneration in the T1 sagittal again, I predict that it will be almost impossible to repair this rotator cuff and that it will function again. I may be heroically able to repair it, but I will tell my patient, this will not work. So I go inside, and if I find that the tendon is not reducible to its original footprint, I won't try to push it. So I'll repair the subscapularis. I don't think it's a contraindication, the torn subscapularis, unless it has also Gutallier 4 grade fatty degeneration, but almost always it's possible to repair. So I repair subscapularis. I usually always do the tenotomy of the long head of the biceps because it's a pain generator. But also almost half of my patients don't have a long head of the biceps anymore anyway there because they have massive irreparable rotator cuff tear. So it's part of the natural history. And then I do the superior capsule reconstruction in these patients and repair the remaining infraspinatus. To the footprint, to the posterior marginal rotator cuff. So this is my algorithm of decision. I know it's a little bit different from the professors, but in my hands, it's what seems to work best.
Yeah, one comment from me, and to improve the pseudoparalysis and to increase apparent distance, it really depends on the stiffness of the graft. If the stiff, you can make a stiff graft, you can make more stability. That's why the humerus depressed them. In my experience, the pseudoparalysis improved, but actually reversed. After elevation increase, but it still migrated superiorly. In that case, it's hard to improve actual elevation most of the patients. So it really depends on the graft. That's why the dermal graft, it's not stiff. That's why maybe you cannot see any the increased apparent distance after surgery. And even fascia rata, if you cannot make a stiff graft, thicker graft either makes stiffer. So maybe you should make a thick graft. And also one more thing, to make the stiff graft, I usually do many suturing on the graft. Then graft become stiff. That's why my graft is very stiff. That's why just a surgery, even the Hamada grade 3 or 4 and the no space and the acromion, but around 1 centimeter, you can see the space. So it's a really, maybe only the fascia rata graph, maybe you can see this increase acromion distance. Maybe dermal graph may be difficult, but if you can make a more stiffer graph using the dermal graph, maybe you can get more better result. It's my comment here. I'm sorry, yeah, please go ahead.
So John, what type of graft do you use?
So I've used fascia lata. I've used allograft like Conexa, xenograft, and I've used the human dermal matrix allograft. Those are the three grafts that I have the most experience with. The human dermal matrix allograft for us is easily available, and it has changed. When it was initially, when the SCR was first popularized in the United States to graft, the human dermal graft was thinner, and now they are 4 millimeters and even 6 millimeters thick. So you have added the initial strength at time zero. And so some of those early failures of pullout are not occurring now because of the thicker graft.
Having experience with all this type of graft, do you believe that when we speak about the results of SCR, should we differentiate depending the type of graft we use?
Absolutely. I think that there is variation in technique, whether you use different grafts, whether you are using 2 or 3 anchors at the glenoid or not, whether you are repairing the upper subscapularis to the anterior portion of the graft or not. Some people do not. They're concerned about loss of external rotation and to what degree your posterior repair occurs. So I think there's variations which need to be substratified and looked at.
Zan, have you ever thought to use SCR with a tendon transfer?
No, I never done that, no. Maybe a good idea could be to take the long head of biceps, if still present, and to use as SCR, biologic SCR, plus a lat dorsi. The other idea is to make a partial repair plus lat dorsi. Why not? But in my technique, I will show you tomorrow when I do my lat dorsi. In fact, I reduce the curve from the back to the superior. So in fact, when you do a lat dorsi, automatically you do a posterior partial repair. The question is, why not using the biceps? But I have no experience with SCR plus lat dorsum.
Anna Katerina, do you believe, apart from the thickness of the graph, that the fixation and the position of the arm play some role in the success of the graph, of the result?
I think we still have a lot to learn about the properties of the perfect graft. It's not just thickness, it's not just how stiff it is. The stiffness is a very precise measurement, and we know it from the implants that we put in arthroplasty. It's very important, and we're trying to simplify something that it's not simple. That's why we don't have a lot of answers. But I think that in the years to come, probably with more biomechanical studies, more directed, we'll try to understand what are the best mechanical properties of a graft. It's not just the spacer effect. It's not just the tenodesis effect. It's not one or the other. Maybe it's both. Maybe it's the position of the arm when you put the anchors in the greater tuberosity maybe plays some role. We don't know, it's all theoretical. And I think that probably if each of us do SCR today, we'll all do it differently. So yes, we have to try and reach a consensus, but it's very theoretical for me to say that, yes, I think that 40 or 10 or 20 degrees of abduction, yes, it will improve.
Okay. Thank you. Clara, what do you do with the long head of biceps?
I always, when it's present, I always cut it. In our last case, after we harvested the fascia lata, we didn't achieve the 5 millimeter minimum thickness that we aim for. And so we had a very good long head of the biceps, so we grafted it on the fascia lata. So I think we should not waste it vainly. We can use it as an augmentation also in the fascia lata procedure. So it depends on the case.
Okay. So John, do you perform acromioplasty or not?
Yes. But I'm a minimalist. I don't do a cutting block technique. I just will trim off the little bump of a couple millimeters and just stimulate perhaps some autogenous growth factors, et cetera, into the space. But I'm a minimalist when it comes to that. But I did want to bring up one point about, I think what's an interesting question that I still debate personally is, you know, we've all had patients where a partial repair can improve the force couple adequately and improve pain and function to some degree. And so to what point do we stop with that, with biceps tenotomy, tenodesis, partial repair, stop, or start adding on SCR, et cetera? That's for me an important unanswered question, is how much can we get away without perhaps going with SCR? Have we abandoned partial repair and stop?
You can still do it.
I don't, but I think that sometimes it's just the discussion you have with patients prior to surgery. I think that it's an option to consider, and maybe in a shared decision-making model, you accept that as your next step versus grafts and potential graft failures and other things. But I don't do. What about the rest of the panel? Have you abandoned partial repair?
You can do it on top of SCR.
You can, Professor, but do you stop just with partial repair?
I think that this is the debate. We should proceed to the next. Okay, Ofer. But please, one comment.
Short. We did with Terry. We did in Argentina. Whoever was there, we did a big symposium exactly on that, what to do. And there were seven of us, and each one presented a different technique, from conservative to partial repair to SCR to a balloon, to reverse, to using a patch and all that. And each one of us showed good results with whatever he did. So I think the whole idea of whatever we do is to restore the force couple. And I think we should greet ourselves now as shoulder surgeon, may the force couple be with you.
Thank you. Okay. Thank you, the panelists. Thank you, Professor Mihata. We continue the conversation, the discussion outside, because we should continue the program. Okay? Thank you.
Yes, thank you very much.